Okay, so thanks to Sarah and Jack for taking us through some of the detail. Now's an opportunity for any questions or comments anybody wants to raise. Bill, were you asking, are we actually talking about commissioning for the third sector?
Yeah,
the missing of this stuff. That's what that means. Right. Okay. Right, Sheena.
Yes, thanks. Clearly, this, in terms of the sort of high level strategy and you know, where this is all sort of set to absolutely fit in the vision of 2018, I think you know, it makes absolute sense. One of the things clearly, and it is sort of an iterative process, and absolutely recognise it takes time to sort of work through all these things, is actually understanding even better both the schemes in terms of contacts and therefore their impact and how they then help with the achieving the metrics that we need to achieve. But also, one of the things that's quite difficult to kind of follow through is almost the bridge analysis that says, because this is existing money, is in one part it's quite clear to see where the money source is because it's existing spend that's there. But the rest of the things, what I'm not clear about, is the source of those funds and therefore how to then bridge from where the money sits at the moment and what impact that might have on changes to services that exist at the moment, because obviously we need to be taken out of those services to actually create the money to actually do the new services and what transitional requirements there are. So sort of taking this to an example, which is fully not one that isn't a CWP one, is clearly we know that the assumption is there'll be a huge reduction, a fairly large reduction in the number of emissions to this hospital's trust, and that obviously will then impact on the infrastructure in there. But it's not actually following that through so that we, when as providers, we can actually in our annual plans track what that means for both those who provide services but also our funding services. So it's that sort of bridge analysis about where's the money now, where does it need to change from, and to create the fund for those. Because that is it's not new money. Somewhere primarily the healthcare system.
I mean, I'm not the expert on finance, but I think there is generally there's a problem with this because you ask for that, we cannot directly, then we will be saying we are taking out of the contract for a provider to pay for these things. That is what we ultimately, this money is coming, the source of all of this is no other source other than CCG resources, bottom line. Quite simply, at the CCG, we have to manage the bottom line. The part of it we can relate to, which is the reenablement, etc. Apart from that, resources very minimal. We understand that the very minimal amount of resources is possible for integration of the system to read one data from one another, so that, for example, the integrated team, etc., can actually see what's in the health system or in the social care system, so that they don't have to duplicate the assessment, etc. This is not a one single system or single consultancy. It's about creating an information. And we are doing another big piece of work on the media, etc., where we're trying to bring data from primary care, hospital, CT, and others together in the system. So I hope I answered.
So are we sort of moved on that, or are we just
slowly?
So I was going to say, one of the things that is in place, clearly there are some very strong information systems around. One of the opportunities we have is bringing the logic in terms of a new system in the social care arena is that has a facility called Visio that allows those systems to look at each other, if you like. And what you see is that core information about an individual. Each of the health and social care systems can link into that. So then what you get is the top, if you like, information about an individual. Clearly we have to be careful about sharing information and it's more appropriate for people in the system. But we have the facility to do that for them.
From the governance structure that we've set up, we're under the acute sector that says 15% reduction in emergency admissions for people who are 9.3 million efficiency. What it's saying is we currently spend 62 million on A&E type services, and if you had 15% less, that's 9.3 million. That's going to be obvious. What's less obvious is we have 94,000 patients with A&E. If you take a 15% reduction, that's 81. still presumably one function in the A&E department, and it's just thinking about how we work together across that whole time.
And can I just add to that, Abby? I know you're looking back. I mean, presumably, there's still some very detailed discussions need to take place around the actual practicalities of moving stuff from the queue to the community centre.
Absolutely. And the only other thing I think is a 20% reduction. We have to be really careful about what we're saying and we're interpreting, and we can decide what we're going to do. But I made the note that actually Chris Hamm said that we were looking at 20% productivity gain in electric here. Now we're.
You can change that language.
Yeah, because actually we're already doing a lot of that. The system's demanding that we are much more productive on electric here. Therefore, I think what we're saying is we want to do ideally less electric here, or the electric here we do. That is different than a 20% reduction in plant care. We just need to be thoughtful if that's what we really want to do.
Andrew, to answer the last point, Karen, I think we should be mindful about, we need to see what the regulation says. Is it productivity or is it actually activity? Or is it based on, my understanding is that it's based on a time and place and it needs some reduction. But I'm not prepared as a teacher. Look into that to say whether it's a productivity gain or it's actually a real term gain. As far as the 15% of the idea of 20% is concerned, yes, I assume that there will be a reduction, but we are staying, and every attendance is, and the number of attendances that go, but not of minor and important, that can very well be dealt with elsewhere, which costs significantly. Maybe 50%, 60% cheaper than what would happen. So we cannot simply say that because we have an A&D, we will go on just pumping more into that unless we've got an agreement in any contraction to deal with. We haven't got a tariff to say for minor problems, we are not going to charge ABR. So we have to drive down the A&D, and we have to understand that the rest of the country, A&D activity is going shooting up 8%, 9%, 10%, etc. We are level pegging on just 1.75%. That is completely against the national trend. We've done that because we've developed a number of community urgent care centers, walking centers, and coming to there. And if anything, we would like to do more. We've identified there are parts of the centers that we need to do. I think we should welcome the fact that we are trying to do things to take the. Just because there is a building, we can't just go on saying, like, just send everybody out there. We have created that by having a number of floors that are on par over 18 years, and I think we cannot sustain that for a long time.
Yes, I disagree with that. What I would say, if we can look to reduce demand and actually either have that demand satisfied elsewhere, or we can reduce it completely, that's fine. But I guess what I'm just saying is that we need to agree on just the fixed costs, because if there's less activity, there's less income. And therefore, what I can't do is have all the costs of running an A&E department and then make less income, because that way it just doesn't work. And then we just need to work together on how we do that together.
That's the very reason why Sheila's question I answered by saying we have not said that this money is coming out of the economy, because we need to do transition of payment, etc. for many of these things.
Okay. I've got Phil.
I think what was more concerning for us,
sorry, you wanted to sort of
define
that.
Perhaps you'd have made this point at the beginning that one of the pieces of work that's ongoing at the moment is we're doing modelling work and looking at the schemes in terms of baseline, where we are, what will be delivered, what impact we expect to have. And then at the end of that, we will add it up and say, is that enough to meet the target, the overall target that we have for the whole world? And that piece of work is ongoing at the moment with the public health outcomes.
How do we sort of start to move this over time to be actually about better care and how
recognise that that's what it's used for. The national targets are driven very much about how do we get the existing system to change. But what we really need to be focusing on being able to have a broad picture, and otherwise we really won't be making a difference in the population outcomes.
Yeah.